Good morning. This is Dr. John Bennett broadcasting from Miami Beach. In the background, we have another episode of Daily, a dose of neurosurgery education. We have the pleasure of having Vladimir Benes, a neurosurgeon that probably everybody knows from the Czech Republic. So why don't we just go straight ahead? Welcome, Vlad. It's all yours.
Okay. Thank you, John. Hello, everyone. I believe that this is a little about general education as well. And people are from all over the world. So let me show you where the Czech Republic is, just in the middle of the Europe. This is the capital. It's Prague. It's the most beautiful city in the world. You all are welcome as soon as the frontier will be open. We have had few important people living here in the city. It was Emil Zátopek, who in 1952 won 5,000, 10,000 marathon in one Olympics. Not a single Kenyan or Ethiopian runner is able to do that again. Then we had Chaszczaska, who won 7 gold Olympic medals in gymnastics in Tokyo and in Mexico later, who lived in Prague. An important people you might know, Franz Kafka, he was a citizen of Prague, Albert Einstein, and Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart. Actually, Don Giovanni was first performed in Prague. From a neurosurgical point of view, there were two important people. It was Hans Kejari, who described his developmental disorder here in Prague, and the specimen got lost at the end of the World War II. And you all know probably Purkinje cells in the cerebellum. It's not only Prague in the city, there are many more cities which are beautiful and nice. Yeah, and we have lots of castles and chateaus all over the country, so it's a really touristic paradise. Not now, lots of spa and lots of resorts, even in the winter. You can come, and the countryside is, it's green. That's the most important thing, probably. Mellow, no high hills, no Alps, no high mountains like in, Nepal. The important sport is ice hockey. You probably do not know that. That's the fastest collective game in the world. They really run on skates very, very fast, and it's very violent, actually. The pastime of all the citizens is skiing. You know, as soon as there is some snow, everybody skis. These two people you probably know, it's Ivan Lendl and Navratilova, the famous tennis players, and tennis is really one of the important sports. This lady was number one for several weeks. This lady won Wimbledon for several, two times she won Wimbledon actually. And this guy was in top 10 for several years. Football, of course, is sport number one, but we are not that good at it. This is our most important industry. It's automotive. It makes something like 40% of GNP. This is Škoda car, which is part of Volkswagen Group. And these cars are real good. And you get a good value for your price. We are extremely good in weapons. We produce almost any weapon you may imagine, tanks, jet planes. But small arms is our best. And probably one of the best exports is Semtex. In the 60s, all the terrorists all over the world were shopping like crazy in our country for this product. But the best and probably the most important is the beer. You see that it's Pilsner beer, and we have Pilsen. That's a city where the beer is originated. And this is the brewery in Pilsen where this thing is produced. It's really probably the best thing we have here in this country, along with the girls who drink it, and you get lots of beautiful girls here. Okay, let's go to aneurysms now. Now you know everything about my country. This is my assistant professor thesis, which I have written in 1992 on surgery of brain aneurysm. It was 250 pages, and because I wanted to have everything there, I put something about endovascular treatment. And to endovascular treatment, only one page was devoted. At that time, it really was at the beginning, and it was like something experimental and something which everyone knew about, but no one really used. Everything has changed very fast. At 2000, this became really a routine treatment of the aneurysms. And there is some, say, general rule. Everyone thinks that new is better, which not always may be true. Everyone thinks that endovascular is non-invasive. It's not true. You may produce the same disaster from within as from without. So it's not really non-invasive, as we all believe. The patients love it, of course, because it's one puncture in the groin and that's it. And recently, anyone must be brave to clip the aneurysms, because it's much more dangerous than 20 years ago. When there was the only one technique, we were doing all the aneurysms without any hesitancy, because there was no other possibility. Now you really must be brave to go for basilar tip aneurysm, and you must be very sure of yourself. There were two randomized trials on the treatment of aneurysm. This is the famous one, ISAT. We participated in it, and see what really it's showing now. The difference between the red line, which is surgical treatment, and blue line, which is endovascular treatment, is nothing really that big. It's, of course, less than, P is less than 0.05, so it's nice, it's statistically significant. But look what happens 15 years after. The lines are parallel on the same slope. We shall come to that later, and you will see why this is happening. Of course, the authors of the trial now will tell you that still endovascular treatment is better, but it's not true. Now it's becoming to be a religion, and it's a religion of evidence-based medicine. This is the other. This is Brad from Phoenix. And what they found, that difference did not reach the statistical significance, despite the fact that the endovascular treatment was a little better than the surgical treatment, even in this single institution trial. So, all right, let's consider endovascular treatment better than the surgical one. We shall see that this is not that much true very soon. All these trials and all this evidence-based is nothing more than traffic signs. Everyone understands it. This is like general rule all over the world, that the police wants you to drive 40. You must get there to realize whether in 40 you will not hinder all the other traffic, or whether you will destroy your car driving 40 there. Or maps. Everyone knows how to read the map. Everyone understands the map. But you really must get there to realize what it really looks like. And this is the same with the patients. You must keep in mind your general rules, but you must decide very individually with each patient in front of you. That's the only way. So we were first interested, what is the aneurysm treatment in Europe? And this we did in 2010. Published, it was 2012. This is a we did with Mendeloff. You probably know this guy from intracerebral hemorrhage studies, and with Susie Hyde, who was at that time the secretary of EANS. From European Union point of view, Europe is divided into four regions. It's the East, including Czech Republic. It is the North, which is Scandinavia and Britain. South, which are all the Mediterranean countries. And the West, which is dominantly Germany and France. For ruptured aneurysms, at that time, 10 years ago, the relation between in endovascular and surgical treatment was 2-1 in the East and 1-2 in the North, completely reversed, but both were happy. No one was complaining about the aneurysm treatment. For unruptured aneurysms, it was 1-1 in the East, and 3 out of 5 aneurysms were clipped in the West. So you see that the differences were major, and no one really complained, because the results were comparable and everyone was happy with the results. So So we were interested then in our single center results, what we are doing, what we were doing, how we were treating our patients. So we took the 10 years period when we had both modalities available on a routine basis, 24/7. We had two surgeons, two endovascular neuroradiologists performing the procedures, and we have needed, had nearly 1,200 aneurysms at the time. 780 were treated endovascularly and 366 surgically. So the relation was 70-30, more like in the Northern Europe than in the Eastern Europe. And our policy in treating the aneurysm was really deliberate. We treated all the patients who came in. If I will overdo it, we first treated the aneurysm and then we treated the patient. So as soon as the patient came into our hospital, with no respect to timing, with no respect to the patient's condition, we treated the aneurysm and then we treated the patient. This is our surgical team, this is our endovascular team. We treat them with compassion and friendship. However, we do not listen to them and we are the ones who decide about the mode of treatment because we are the clinicians. These are the radiologists. So what were the results? Virtually and exactly the same for both groups. For unruptured, it was 3.5 and 3.3, so no difference whatsoever. And in ruptured aneurysms, which were 600 of them, it was 30% morbidity mortality rate given by the fact that we were treating all the patients. But you wouldn't find a difference in the results in the both groups. We then went for the prognosis of these patients. Again, these are the small aneurysms up to 5 millimeters. These are 5 to 15 millimeters. There is the life expectancy of the Czech population. And in the formula, there are the results of our department. And you see that again, the curves are crossing the zero line at 40 for small aneurysms, at 60 for large aneurysms. For large aneurysms, about 15 millimeters, the lines never cross the zero. So treat all the large aneurysms. The prognosis is so bad that you must. But there were no, again, no differences between surgical and endovascular group. Then we were looking at neuropsychological outcomes of patients. We didn't find any difference in importance of 23 life domains measured by Scala between cold and grip patients, ruptured and unruptured, really no difference whatsoever. And we did something like 600 tests, and those were the day-long tests. The patients were really exhausted after that. In 160 patients, you see the publication did quite a lot, and we really didn't find any difference between the two modalities. So where were we at the time? Always new techniques in endovascular, you know, if you prove to them that this in some part of the aneurysm treatment surgery is better, they say, all right, that's fine, but we are now going to have a new device, like flow diverter, whatever, and it will be like panacea, we should treat all the aneurysms without complications. So you really cannot fight them, and we do not fight them, actually. Again, new is better. If you should read that surgery is obsolete. Even the patients have this impression that surgical aneurysms is obsolete, that everything is to be treated by endovascular means. And was there nothing new in aneurysm surgery over the past 20 years? We actually must be better than endovascular treatment, otherwise we wouldn't have a reason to survive. We wouldn't, as surgeons, survive. So we must be better than they. There must be new things in aneurysm surgery. So it's minimal invasivity. In my mind, minimal invasivity is not keyhole approach or eyebrow approach or whatever. Minimal invasivity is how you behave to the lesion itself. I wouldn't be interested how big an approach would be. I'm interested if the minimal invasivity is executed where the lesion is, directly in the treatment of the lesion. And you see the middle cerebral artery aneurysm here. Here it's clipped. And this is the whole approach in arachnoid. The cut in arachnoid is some 20 millimeters long. This, in my mind, is minimal invasivity, not how big is the craniotomy. This is important. You see what it looks like on a video? This is the only opening between the temporal and frontal lobe. You see the aneurysm here. The dissection is somewhat more difficult, but still you are really just very focused on the aneurysm. You do not damage anything else, but very small amount of frontal and temporal lobe, which are separated within the Sylvian fissure. And you see that you really go directly to the aneurysm. You do not dissect anything else. The dissections of whole Sylvian fissure for middle cerebral aneurysm, in my mind, is something which really is obsolete and unnecessary. If you want to, you may use navigation to hit the aneurysm more properly, because sometimes it's more difficult. And of course, this is easy in cases where the M1 segment is a long one, not a short one. But even in a short M1 segment, you can do this without any difficulty. And this is the same for ruptured and unruptured aneurysms, unless we want to do cisternostomy in ruptured aneurysms to clean the cisterns from the blood. And you see that the clipping is virtually the same. So this is the minimal invasivity in my mind, not the craniotomy. This is important. And the same applies for large aneurysms. And there were quite a lot of developments recently. The video doesn't work, but it's temporary clipping of M1 and M2 segments, and of course suction of the aneurysm sac. Then the clipping of the sac, the base must have been left behind in this case, because there were small perforators coming out of that. And there is, here you see the EC-IC bypass, which in aneurysm treatment is a must. Whoever wants to clip the aneurysm, he must master the bypass techniques. We didn't have 20 years ago ICG, now we do. It's an excellent tool in aneurysms, because you see any occlusion or any stenosis, and you see how the brain is perfused. You see the direction of the flow. So this is the excellent technique. And with exoscope, it's even much better, because you see even the surrounding tissue. We then have the intra-op MR, which is not really useful in aneurysm, but it's a new technique. This is intra-op MR in a case you have seen, and in diffusion-weighted images, you see that you didn't produce any ischemia, that you did a good job. And this is after you see the base of aneurysm, the temporal branch is taken over by the bypass, the frontal branch is working properly. So conclusions as of 5 years ago, what were we thinking about aneurysm? That the results were not excellent. It was like the other in the literature. That was nothing really spectacular. But they were not bad either. They were honest, which is important, because not everyone is giving you honest figures. But what was important for me, that the results are balanced, that they are the same for the both techniques, which means that we probably were choosing the techniques properly. And that the ratio between the endovascular and the direct treatment seems reasonable. And this is what happened with our aneurysm treatment in my department. We started in 1960, and then sometimes in the early 70s, the number of surgery leveled out at 40, which is given by incidence in our region. But these are new patients, the endovascularly treated. The red lines are the new ones. There are twice as many of them. We were treating older patients. We were treating patients in all conditions. We were referred new patients for endovascular treatment. So actually, the endovascular treatment nearly tripled the number of aneurysms which we are treating in my department now. And actually, the merit of treating the aneurysm is excluding the aneurysm from the circulation and preventing the rupture. I do not care if it's achieved by endovascular means or by surgical means. What's important is that on both angios, the aneurysm is not anymore there. And I don't even know which image belongs to which. Actually, this one is prior to this. Here we have two aneurysms which are very similar. One of them is treated endovascularly, the other is treated by surgery. Again, the final result is important, and how you achieve that is not really that important, as long as the patient is doing well and he's just fine. Large AECOM aneurysm treated endovascularly, large ophthalmic aneurysm treated surgically. Again, final result is the important point, not the way how you reach there. Recently, surgically, we can approach almost any part of circle of Willis from simple frontotemporal craniotomy or pterygonal craniotomy or frontolateral craniotomy. Doesn't matter how you call it. The important is what you can reach, and here you see that this is the optic nerve, this is the carotid artery, basilar artery, contralateral P1, contralateral PCOM, ipsilateral sad nerve. So whatever you want, you can reach. If you shift your microscope, you are here in AECOM region, and going further, you get to the opposite side, basilar bifurcation and middle cerebral artery. So it's not really that impossible to reach any aneurysm in the brain. Here it's a little enlarged, and you see that here's the huge vessel, which is this huge posterior communicant chiatic artery, the fetal one on the end pre-op angio. What we did then, we looked on a repeated aneurysm intervention, and suddenly we have found something else, something new, and something we didn't expect in a way, and something that was like good and important data for us in the future. Proportion of retreatment according to treatment modality. In nearly 1400 aneurysms, we had 500 surgically treated, and only 13 needed some retreatment. 13 of them were not treated properly, which is 2.6%. On the other side, in more than 800 aneurysms treated endovascularly, 111 needed some retreatment, which is 12%. Nearly 13% needed some retreatment. And actually, in large aneurysm above 15 millimeters, this ratio is 25%. One out of four large aneurysms treated endovascularly needed retreatment. You see that we went mostly for endovascular treatment again, but 21 of them were surgical. So let's look on these patients more closely, because that's really important. What was the reason for retreatment in surgical group? Incomplete aneurysm occlusion in half of them. Neurosurgeon's decision that clipping would be dangerous, that clipping might cause some disaster. So it was better to quit and go immediately to angio and continue in the same anesthesia with endovascular treatment. It was in four cases. And in two cases, there was the rupture of the aneurysm during craniotomy. For us, this is a stop sign. Don't go forward, don't go for the aneurysm. Quit and go away and come again if the patient survived. So these were the reasons. What did it look like? This is the aneurysm done by my resident when I was not in house. And you see that he left behind part of the aneurysm, which was then treated endovascularly. This is my aneurysm. You see, the one of the surgical tricks is to see the tip of the clip blades at the end of surgery. This is something I always want to see, the tips of the clip. In this case, I was unable to get there to see it, so I didn't feel rather well. So immediately from the OR, we went for angio. This is 20 minutes after surgery. and you see that the sac of the aneurysm is still partially filling. I'm pretty sure that this was thrombosed within the next day, but when we were already there, we filled the sac with the coils and the patient did well. What about the retreatment in endovascular group? That's in three parts. This is the first part when it's partly planned, the second stage of the treatment. Those were the emergency cases where we put some coils in just to prevent the rupture, and then we came again and treated the aneurysm permanently. In some of the cases, this was intentional. In some of these cases, it was not intentional, but this is not something for which I would blame the technique. This is the regrowth of the aneurysm. One part is after the partial occlusion, and the other part is after the so-called total occlusion. But that was the most frequent group, regrowth of the aneurysm. That's something with which we shall be fighting in future, again and again. And that it was complete failure of the technique, that they were unable to treat the aneurysm. So some of them went for retreatment, for endovascular retreatment, but the majority went for where we switched for surgical. And these three groups are nearly identical. What did it look like? This is the acoma aneurysm in a patient. The Hunten has four. He put some clip in. The occlusion was not complete. So when the patient improved, he went in again and we filled more coils into the aneurysm sac. Patient was doing well. Another one, this is the again, a ruptured aneurysm, Hunten has one. We put stent in, the aneurysm reformed in a way into some other shape, and this was filled with the coils in the second stage surgery. So this is something like intentional. This is carotid bifurcation aneurysm. Again, the young coiler did it. He overlooked this part of the aneurysm, or he interpreted it as a loop. So this was done in the second stage. Most typical one, the basal bifurcation aneurysm, they almost all regrow, or this is the most typical what you see half a year or a year after your surgery, and you must go ahead and fill the rest of the aneurysm. Unruptured acoma aneurysm, regrowth, we put stents in, you see the markers, and then we put another coils in, and this was the final image after some 6 weeks. This is something like a dissecting aneurysm which ruptured during the procedure. This is not subarachnoid bleeding. This is the contrast media everywhere in the subarachnoid spaces. So we filled that, that was nice, except for the base, there was something little which didn't fit. The aneurysm regrew. So new coils, this was very satisfactory. The patient came in, this again filling, so another coils, another stents, all over. Finally, we produced the infarction of the occipital lobe. So the lady has a homonymous hemianopia. And this is the final image some 16 years later. So it was from in 1916, seven procedures and aneurysm is still filling and we do not know how to treat that. Of course, this is not the aneurysm I would be able to treat surgically. This is a dissecting thing in the mid-vessel region. So this probably was the only way how to treat the lady. Another one, this is from the beginning of our practice, with endovascular. Just trying to connect to this. From 2000, this one ruptured, and we were able to fill this one with coil, but the coil was unable to stabilize the catheter in this aneurysm, so this aneurysm was surgery. Well, she came in some 16 years later. The regrowth of the aneurysm, of course, there was much discussion between the group and the one that did it by surgery or the one that did it by was years obvious that the one treated like horse we do. So we treat the pain and the ladies and well, the aneurysm in the other junction, the liver junction is hopefully it's treated permanently. More like one aneurysm on the liver and the aneurysm which is lost and developed in the anterior cerebral artery. So another treatment with another coil which was finally stabilized well. This is the vertebral junction. Quite a large one. I can tell you that at this time I opened that wall. At that time I did it. It went well, everything was fine. Now I really wouldn't do it. I would leave it for it was deeper. On the other hand, these high-cut wounds are something very specific. A female of 32 years, she came in with a glaucoma scale. 5 huge bleeding in front of the brain stem. This is the aneurysm. We did it surgically and they removed quite a lot of blood from her system and they gradually improved and now she's completely normal. So this is the case which led us to the philosophy of treating the ruptured pica aneurysms, which are located laterally by surgical along with something which I would call the system of somatic. So what were the results of the retreatment in our endovascular group? The hemorrhage after endovascular treatment was in 6.3% in these patients, which is higher than the one expected in a way unruptured aneurysm, because then it were really like unruptured aneurysm. So one would expect 1% or something like that more. In this group, it was 6.3%, quite a lot. Outcome of the retreatment in 124 cases. There were 11 cases of morbidity mortality, which is 9%. Again, it's much higher than the expected one, which would be like 3%. So it's not a really benign procedure and benign condition, because both rupture rate and complication rate during the treatment is much higher. And this image and this figure is exactly why the ICE patients now are slowly reversing from endovascular to surgical treatment, which will in future be better even in ISA patients. So this you do not see in surgical group. In surgical group, we have zero reaction rate. There is none. So residual failing at last control, and it's important. In endovascular flow, and 47%. Half of the patients have some aneurysms when they were treated for their original aneurysm. In those who were treated, the very small group is 50. And in those which were from endovascular to if you remember, there was some 21 patients. All of them are. And this figure is somewhat tragic. It's over the study runs over 50 years, and half of the patients is not treated, not properly, but sufficiently. So it's quite a high number. Of all the group, it's 6.3 of all endovascularly treated patients. But actually, our endovascularly treated patients are not followed that closely. We know about the ruptures, not all of them probably, but about the majority, but we do not follow the endovascular treatment patients that long and that closely. So this figure probably would be similar in the whole group. And now we see CTGO, you close all the troubles. So the conclusion of this treatment. Usually caused by initial insufficient aneurysm occlusion. not always, but it was most often was. The risk factors were this more vividly enlarged, one out of four, infused form, and dissecting, which is obvious. So these three conditions were really at high risk of refilling, regrowth, and retreatment. Endovascular treatment carries definite risk of rebleeding, which is something like 6% in our series. It's quite a lot. Technical effectivity, which is important, almost half of repeatedly endovascularly treated patients showed some signs of residual aneurysm filling at last control, whenever the last control was performed, which is really something which is quite high compared with 0% of surgical series. So technical superiority of surgery is very obvious, and this is something which one should and may use while advising the patient. The patients should know about it. They shouldn't be hearing only about the minimal invasive approach, about the gentle approach, about the risk-free approach. They should hear about the retreatment and about the regrowing of the aneurysm. I don't know if the video will play, but this is the simple ophthalmic aneurysm, which is very easy to clip. You are done with your surgery within 10 minutes. And you then, as Juha Hernesniemi, whom you all know, says, you kill the aneurysm, you coagulate the sac, you inspect the vessel, you inspect your clip, and you know you are done, and you know that you will never ever see the patient again, only at regular checkups. This is never true with endovascular treatment. With endovascular treatment, you should follow your patients closely, say forever. Not with the surgical cases. Another case in favor of surgery. And then these five aneurysms could hardly be treated in one session endovascularly, but these five aneurysms are treated by surgical means from one simple small frontolateral approach. Not that difficult, not that specific. So what are our conclusions and what can we say about the endovascular treatment? The more blood in subarachnoid space, the more we go for endo. That's pretty sure, and that's undisputable, because we cannot avoid that surgery by all means is just another hit for already damaged brain by the original subarachnoid hemorrhage. So whenever there is lots of blood, we go for endovascular. In some cases, of course, this may not be true with Ipcharian and his cisternostomy, which is virtually the same as in brain injury. The worse the WFNS score, the more we go for endo. Again, this is the same reason, another hit to already injured brain. The older the patient, of course, we go for endo. There, the instability of the treatment is not of such an issue as in young patients. The more midline aneurysm, the more we go for endo. It is a AECOM basal artery. The distal anterior cerebral artery is in questionable. There, both techniques gives you good results. But in AECOM and in basal artery, of course, it's more for endo. In middle cerebral artery, we never ever discuss with them again because they all go for surgery. And the more medium size the aneurysm is, the more we go for endo. If they fail technically, they fail in really small aneurysm and in really large aneurysm. So the more medium size aneurysm, the more endovascular. These are the publications we have. You probably may see that small, but COIL mainly, policy in AECOM aneurysms was one article. And the other article was clip first policy in middle cerebral artery aneurysms. And there are all the figures which really prove that. So it's not a competition. It's not like that they are our enemies or adversaries or something like that. They are our colleagues. And I'm not a big fan of those hybrid surgeons. I do not think that you can be world champion in table tennis and in skiing. You can be world champion in one discipline only. So there should be a team which works closely, which we are lucky to have really close relations, and they are actually part of our team. So it's a quest of balance. It's not a question yes or no, definitely not. The question is which technique is suitable for particular patient, where no randomized control trial can help you in that. This is really individual decision. And this is what Juha has been showing us for many years, and he was completely wrong. I admire Juha very much, but you see in this that he was showing this is the last Mohican, and he is the last Mohican of aneurysm treatment. But actually this guy is Uncas, son of Chingachgook, and he's really Mohican. He's rather wild, unresponsible. He falls in love with English girl Cora, and he was killed in a fight with Magua. This is from James Fenimore Cooper Pentalogy. It was a very famous movie. And this last Mohican who was killed, he was killed by Magua, who was Huron, and he's the main negative character of the book. He's more at life figure in a way. And this guy was then killed by Chingachgook. And this is the guy, and this is the last Mohican, because he was the only one who remained there. He's intellectual, he's negotiator, he's a very tolerant man, and he's a survivor. So this is the true last Mohican. And the same is the last stand. This is the not the last stand for surgeons, because we shall be here even in future, and we shall be treating aneurysms. And the last stand is very heroic. It's beautiful history. It's something to admire and something to believe in. But last stand was Thermopyle. And if you remember from your history, Thermopyle was a defeat. They lost. So don't go for this. Let's go for win. And let's go for a good cooperation with endovascular people. Thank you.
Okay, Dr. Shah.
Yeah, yeah. Go
ahead.
Thank you, Dr.
Pinesh. Hello. Hello. Can you hear me? Yes. Hello, Abhija. Yes. How are you doing?
Fine, fine. How are you?
Good to see you.
Good to see you, yeah.
Great.
Thank you for that excellent lecture and a good balance between surgery and endovascular. So
thank you.
We can now open the floor for any questions. Do we have any questions?
Yeah, hello.
Go ahead.
Yeah, lad. Hello, lad. Thank you very much for this beautiful presentation.
Hi.
One question was, what is the incidence of vasospasm between open and endovascular in your experience? And what is the standard of care for prevention of vasospasm in your department?
Yeah. We actually didn't check for the vasospasms that closely, but it was the same for endovascular and surgical group. There were no differences, and we were fighting with vasospasm in both groups in ruptured aneurysms, and we were treating them like everyone else with triple H therapy, with endovascular treatment, but there was not real difference which would say somehow that in this group there were more of them. No.
That is contradicting to the common literature, which says more blood, that is more vasospasm.
I don't hear you.
That is contradictory to what the common literature says, that there is more blood, there should be more vasospasm. So surgical arm should have lesser vasospasm because you are not taking out the blood within the cisterns in endovascular group.
Very true. I would expect that, but we really didn't see the difference. But we didn't look for them that closely. They were not in the forefront of our curiosity.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
John?
Yes, go ahead, Dr. Goel. Go ahead.
Yeah. Vlad, that was a fantastic presentation.
Thank you.
My question to you is, Vlad, see, there are, of course, endovascular is there, surgery is there. There is no question. Both are complementary and both are good. But there are certain aneurysms which we were doing all the time, like basilar top aneurysm, basilar artery aneurysm, vertebral artery aneurysm, internal carotid artery aneurysm. Now, all these aneurysms particularly are completely not surgical. Intracavernous aneurysms. We were doing intracavernous aneurysm 20 years ago by surgery, opening the cavernous sinus and doing all kind of surgical maneuvering and bleeding and all those things. Don't you think that gradually they are eventually going to take over? You see, now they are doing paraclinoid aneurysm. They are coming up. Then they are coming up to internal carotid artery aneurysm. Now they are going to bifurcation aneurysm, also to middle cerebral bifurcation aneurysm. So don't you think this technology is increasing and eventually they might just take over? What do you have to say?
That's very true what you are saying. There are several factors which are in endovascular favor. First thing is really this so-called minimal invasivity. One puncture in a groin, no doubt about that. The second fact is that they are going to the aneurysms which we were doing easily, like middle cerebral posterior communicating ophthalmic aneurysms. And of course, they are doing those which we were doing with some difficulties, like intracavernous aneurysms. That was not easy surgery. But what's probably most important in future, that we shall not have followers. Tell me, how can you teach someone to do properly aneurysms when there is active endovascular service which is taking over? You see it in France. In France, everything is done endovascularly, and the patients are not even anymore informed that there is surgery for aneurysms. You know, it's really, we have left a big field behind. I'm afraid of that. I'm afraid that in future, majority will be done by endovascular means, and surgeons will be like in reservations, the same like rhinoceros.
Now, another question I want to ask you. What do you think is the role of endovascular surgery for arteriovenous malformation, AVM treatment?
Honestly, none.
Yeah, I agree with you. I completely agree with you.
None. We don't use it anymore. We quit. Very, 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 very seldom there is an exception with huge cerebral AVMs. Then they may help a bit, but I don't use it anymore. Very, very, very seldom.
Okay.
Very good. We have a question here from Duong from Vietnam. His signal is poor. He says, I disagree with your first conclusion. With a severe SA, the surgery procedure can wash out the hematoma and rule out the CSF. It will help for ICU. What do you think?
The person disagrees with opening this CSF pathway, so I didn't hear you well, John.
Oh, okay. I disagree with your first conclusion. Duong, can you clarify? You disagree with the first conclusion?
What's meant.
Can I explain?
Go ahead, Daddy. Go ahead.
Okay, he's saying that he believes that a craniotomy will help to wash out the blood and then let out CSF. Probably that will reduce intracranial pressure. Yes. And help ICU care.
Yes.
Instead of endovascular.
Thanks,
that's
Daddy.
What he's saying.
Thank you, Dad.
That's perfectly true. That's perfectly true. I don't disagree with this statement. However, the more blood is usually joined with a bad clinical condition, which was the point two of my conclusion. And whoever did emergency surgeries in patients with a lot of saponinated blood and with a lot of with bad condition, this was called angry and swollen brain. And that was really, that's really not easy to get into the basal systems. You really do not get the relaxed brain for a long, long time unless you really open the systems. So it's really, in my mind, this is really another hit to already injured brain. So I would prefer endovascular in these patients. Certainly, there are many articles that if you wash blood from your cisterns, you do not have vasospasm, and if you wash blood from your cistern, the patient will improve in clinical condition. But in my mind, this angry and swollen brain is nothing I would like to encounter during aneurysm surgery.
Nicholas has a question. I'm sorry, Dr. Shah. I'm taking over again.
No problem.
Nicholas, you have a question?
I want first to congratulate my dear friend, Professor Vladimir Benes. It was my teacher during the EANS courses, and I will always remember him with a great friendship. Dear Professor Benes, one question. According to your prestigious opinion, who has to do the embolization procedures? A neuroradiologist or perhaps a neurosurgeon after his basic training that he has to do after to specialize in this particular field? Because it's a big question, who will make all these embolization procedures?
This is a good question. And this is something which I really do not have yet sorted in my mind, but what I prefer is a neuroradiologist. When we started in 2000 or 1999, there was a neuroradiologist in our hospital, and I told him, all right, you are going to do endovascular, but first you will be as a resident in my department for 6 months to learn something about the clinical picture, to learn what the patient looks like actually, and these things. He did it. And since that time, he's doing all the endovascular treatment with now two other colleagues, although neurologists. But he is like part of our team. He's coming to our morning conferences. There is not a single aneurysm which he or I would decide as one person. We always discuss that, you know, and it's the best I would like to have. But I understand that this is not always possible to have a neuroradiologist as a part, as part of the team who really actually listens to you and who really obeys you, because I'm slightly above him in the hierarchy. And I own the patients. If a neurosurgeon learns the technique, okay, let him do it. He probably will be doing it well. But you may remember, if you went through Europe, there was one neurosurgeon who was doing endovascular treatment as well. And he was giving lectures. And there was a time that the endovascular was better. Then he had a complication with his endovascular treatment, and he switched for surgery. And for a time, again, surgery was better for a while. So he was like fighting within himself, which I don't feel is good. I always think that two brains know more than one brain, and two brains can come to some better conclusion than one brain. So, and as I said, you cannot be really world champion in both disciplines. So I don't like these hybrid people, and whoever does that must have some background in the clinical neurosurgery or neurology, and he or she should be part of the neurosurgical team, because this is and should be done only from neurosurgical ward. You know, I made sure in my hospital that not a single intervention, the most minor one, which is within the neural system, will be done from other bed than the neurosurgical one. Everything. And that's probably important. Did I answer your question?
As always, you did. Thank you very much. We are waiting soon you back in Greece when coronavirus will pass. We are waiting for you, okay?
Hope so. That's the worst thing not to travel.
May I do a question, please?
Yeah, go ahead.
Hello, Professor. Christian from Slovakia.
Hello.
Greeting to you. I would like to ask, please, what can you recommend for young neurosurgeons who wants to do a cerebrovascular surgery in the future?
This is difficult question. This is difficult. The only thing how he can do vascular, and I don't think that this is a subspecialty with a bright future. It was a subspecialty with a bright future in my time. But if someone would like to do it now, he or she should go to high volume department. That's the only way. In a low volume or in a medium volume department, one will never learn that. But the only way would really be a high volume department with something like 100, 120 aneurysms per year, 20 AVMs at least, like 20, 25 cavernomas. The one who is doing carotid endarterectomies, which is the best for vascular, like 100 endarterectomies, something like that.
Okay, thank you. I hope in Slovakia it will be possible one day, maybe.
I'm afraid there is none in Slovakia. Like
one question from the panelists.
Yeah.
I wanted to know your opinion about endovascular prospect, example thrombectomy or contact suction for treating embolic strokes.
That's a huge field now, because the neurologists for the first time in history are treating also. That's something which is excellent, because suddenly we are able to treat stroke. And we have a very, very active stroke unit in my hospital. We are doing like 100 mechanical thrombectomies a year, and it's miraculous. It's a really miracle, and it's not only middle cerebral, it's basal artery, which is perfect. And this should also be part of neurosurgery, because we are the ones who are best suited to treat stroke. It's emergency. We are suited to treat emergencies, not the neurologist. It's intensive care. We know our neuro intensive care, unlike neurologists who have, let's say, 5-6 Jean Barres a year. So whenever possible, this should be grabbed by a neurosurgeon, and it really has a bright future. It really has a bright future, because not all patients have transient ischemic attacks which get them to the hospital in time. Many patients still come with stroke and still will be coming with stroke. And I see it with in my country that slowly but gradually the patient gets aware about the transient ischemic attack, that it's really important and that it's really an emergency. You know, the biggest disadvantage of stroke is that there is no pain involved. Everyone knows that if he has a pain in a thoracic region, he or she should go to the hospital to get some stent, not with ischemic attacks. But now slowly and gradually the population learns that, and I believe that this will be a big, big future in neurosurgery. Should we keep it for ourselves?
Yeah, we should, I guess. And how are the results? Meaning, is there a time frame, or the results even after 6 hours, or is the dawn trial? Do you see the results even after, you know, maybe 12 hours?
Even later. The timing actually is individual. You get these CT scans which you can use for evaluation, and I don't know how they call it, you know, the discrepation that there are patients whom you can treat even later. And as I remember, the guidelines are not that strict anymore. You have no time restriction for basilar artery. So why should it be for middle cerebral?
Yeah,
we treat them later. Even later.
Okay. So does anyone else have any question?
Don't be shy. What other lines can I use, Dr. Shah, to get people off their mouse? There's another the mouse is a surgical tool in these days.
Okay, there is one question on the chat box.
Okay. Yeah.
What is the time limit when you would say that I will not attempt thrombectomy?
There is no time limit, but there is the CT. If on CT I will see a huge infarction, say like nearly whole MCA territory, then I will say not do it. Yeah. No time, but CT image. With a huge infarction, which is definitive, I wouldn't go for that.
Coming back to aneurysms, do you have any kind of aneurysm that you would not opt for a surgical treatment and straight say go for endovascular? Any particular?
There are none. There is none. Actually, the one I don't think much about is mid basilar artery. Those are difficult to approach quite frequently, so those would be where I would opt for endovascular treatment. Then the number two would be the vertebral junction. Vertebral artery junction, if it is located in the midline, not if it is laterally. So for those, I would go for endovascular treatment immediately. And then I can tell you that I don't like ACOMS much. So ACOMS pointing posteriorly would be first choice endovascular treatment.
Okay.
All these.
Okay.
On the other hand, middle cerebral, all of them for surgery, because you see it, then you see everything which the endovascular guy cannot see. You see the part of the distal M1 is part of the aneurysm sac. So this is something which he or she cannot see. So you will treat it more properly. So middle cerebrals are definitely for surgical treatment. Almost all ophthalmic aneurysms, almost all posterior communicating, and those specific pica aneurysms which rupture.
I agree with most of that. There's one more question. Can aneurysms of infective origin be treated endovascularly, or should they be treated at all?
Anything which is not typical, we treat endovascular. All those dissecting, all those these things, the endovascular treatment is better, unless you enjoy bypasses.
So, do we have any other questions?
Okay, very good. Thank you for moderating, and thanks, Vlad. And
thanks everyone for listening to me. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah, I'd like to order a tank. Okay, very good. Thanks all the panelists for coming, and we'll see Vlad at your next talk.
Yep.
Thank you.
Thank you.